Dorothy looked at him curiously. His head was quite bulged out at the top with brains. "How do you feel?" she asked. "I feel wise indeed," he answered earnestly. "When I get used to my brains, I shall know everything."
"Why are those needles and pins sticking out of your head?" asked the Tin Woodman.
"That is proof that he is sharp," remarked the Lion.
"Well, I must go to Oz and get my heart," said the Woodman. So he walked to the throne room and knocked at the door.
"Come in," called Oz. And the Woodman entered the throne room and said, "I have come for my heart."
"Very well," answered the little man, "but I shall have to cut a hole in your chest so I can put your heart in the right place. I hope it won't hurt you."
"Oh, no," answered the Woodman, "I shall not feel it at all."
So Oz brought a pair of tinner's shears and cut a small square hole in the left side of the Tin Woodman's chest. Then, going to a cupboard, he took out a pretty heart made entirely of silk and stuffed with sawdust.
"Isn't it a beauty?" he asked.
"It is indeed," replied the Woodman, who was greatly pleased. "But is it a kind heart?"
"Oh, very," answered Oz.
He put the heart in the Woodman's chest and then replaced the square of tin, soldering it neatly together where it had been cut.
"There," said he, "now you have a heart that any man might be proud of.
I'm sorry I had to put a patch on your chest, but it really couldn't be helped."
"Never mind the patch," exclaimed the happy Woodman. "I am very grateful to you and shall never forget your kindness."
"Don't speak of it," replied Oz.
Then the Tin Woodman went back to his friends, who wished him every joy on account of his good fortune. The Lion now walked to the throne room and knocked at the door.
"Come in," said Oz.
"I have come for my courage," announced the Lion, entering the room.
"Very well," answered the little man. "I will get it for you."
He went to a cupboard and, reaching up to a high shelf, took down a square green bottle, the contents of which he poured onto a green gold dish beautifully carved. Placing this before the Cowardly Lion, who sniffed at it as if he did not like it, the wizard said, "Drink."
"What is it?" asked the Lion.
"Well," answered Oz, "if it were inside you, it would be courage. You know, of course, that courage is always inside one, so that this really cannot be called courage until you have swallowed it. Therefore, I advise you to drink it as soon as possible."
The Lion hesitated no longer, but drank till the dish was empty.
"How do you feel now?" asked Oz.
"Full of courage," replied the Lion, who went joyfully back to his friends to tell them of his good fortune.
For 3 days, Dorothy heard nothing from Oz. These were sad days for the little girl, although her friends were all quite happy and contented. On the 4th day, to her great joy, Oz sent for her, and when she entered the throne room, he said pleasantly,
"Sit down, my dear.
I think I have found the way to get you out of this country."
"And back to Kansas?" she asked eagerly.
"Well, I'm not sure about Kansas," said Oz, "for I haven't the faintest notion which way it lies. But the first thing to do is to cross the desert, and then it should be easy to find your way home. You see, when I came to this country, it was in a balloon. You also came through the air, being carried by a cyclone. So I believe the best way to get across the desert will be through the air. Now, it is quite beyond my powers to make a cyclone. But I've been thinking the matter over, and I believe I can make a balloon. A balloon is made of silk, which is coated with glue to keep the gas in it. I have plenty of silk in the palace, so it will be no trouble to make the balloon. But in all this country there is no gas to fill the balloon with to make it float. However, there is another way to make it float, which is to fill it with hot air. Hot air isn't as good as gas, for if the air should get cold, the balloon would come down in the desert, and we should be lost.
"We?" exclaimed the girl. "Are you going with me?"
"Yes, of course," replied Oz. "I am tired of being such a humbug. If I should go out of this palace, my people would soon discover I was not a wizard, and then they would be vexed with me for having deceived them. So I have to stay shut up in these rooms all day, and it gets tiresome. I'd much rather go back to Kansas with you and be in a circus again."
"I shall be glad to have your company," said Dorothy.
"Thank you," he answered. "Now, if you will help me sew the silk together, we will begin to work on our balloon."
So Dorothy took a needle and thread, and as fast as Oz cut the strips of silk into proper shape, the girl sewed them neatly together. It took 3 days, but when it was finished, they had a big bag of green silk more than 20 feet long. Then Oz painted it on the inside with a coat of thin glue to make it airtight, after which he announced that the balloon was ready.
"But we must have a basket to ride in," he said.
So he sent the soldier with the green whiskers for a big clothes basket, which he fastened with many ropes to the bottom of the balloon. When it was all ready, Oz sent word to his people that he was going to make a visit to a great brother wizard who lived in the clouds. The news spread rapidly throughout the city, and everyone came to see the wonderful sight. Oz ordered the balloon carried out in front of the palace, and the people gazed upon it with much curiosity. The Tin Woodman had chopped a big pile of wood, and now he made a fire of it, and Oz held the bottom of the balloon over the fire so that the hot air that rose from it would be caught in the silken bag. Gradually, the balloon swelled out and rose into the air, until finally the basket just touched the ground. Then Oz got into the basket and said to all the people in a loud voice,
"While I am gone, the Scarecrow will rule over you. I command you to obey him as you would me."
The balloon was by this time tugging hard at the rope that held it to the ground.
"Come, Dorothy," cried the wizard. "Hurry up, or the balloon will fly away."
Dorothy picked Toto up and ran towards the balloon. She was within a few steps of it, and Oz was holding out his hands to help her into the basket. Then, crack, went the ropes, and the balloon rose into the air without her.
"Come back," she screamed. "I want to go too."
"I can't come back, my dear," called Oz from the basket. "Goodbye."
"Goodbye," shouted everyone.
And all eyes were turned upward to where the wizard was riding in the basket, rising every moment farther and farther into the sky. And that was the last any of them ever saw of Oz, the wonderful wizard, though he may have reached Omaha safely and be there now for all we know. The Scarecrow was now the ruler of the Emerald City, and although he was not a wizard, the people were proud of him, for, they said, there is not another city in all the world that is ruled by a stuffed man. And so far as they knew, they were quite right. The morning after the balloon had gone up with Oz, the four travellers met in the throne room and talked matters over. The Scarecrow sat in the big throne, and the others stood respectfully before him. "If Dorothy would only be contented to live in the Emerald City with us," said the Scarecrow, "we might all be happy together."
"But I don't want to live here," cried Dorothy. "I want to go back to Kansas and live with Aunt Em and Uncle Henry."
"Well, then, what can be done?" inquired the Woodman.
The Scarecrow decided to think, and he thought so hard that the pins and needles began to stick out of his brains. Finally, he said,
"Why not call the winged monkeys and ask them to carry you over the desert?"
"I never thought of that," said Dorothy joyfully. "It's just the thing. I'll go at once for the golden cap."
When she brought it into the throne room, she spoke the magic words, and soon the band of winged monkeys flew in through the open window and stood beside her.
"This is the second time you've called us," said the Monkey King, bowing before the little girl. "What do you wish?"
"I want you to fly with me to Kansas," said Dorothy.
But the Monkey King shook his head.
"That cannot be done," he said. "We belong to this country alone and cannot leave it. We shall be glad to serve you in any way in our power, but we cannot cross the desert."
"Is there no one who can help me?" asked Dorothy earnestly.
"Glinda might," suggested the Monkey King.
"Who is Glinda?" inquired the Scarecrow.
"The Witch of the South. She is the most powerful of all the witches and rules over the Quadlings. Besides, her castle stands on the edge of the desert, so she may know the way to cross it."
"Glinda is a good witch, isn't she?" asked the child.
"The Quadlings think she is good," said the Monkey King, "and she is kind to everyone."
"How can I get to her castle?" asked Dorothy.
"The road is straight to the south," he answered, "but it is said to be full of dangers to travellers. There are wild beasts in the woods and a race of strange men who do not like strangers to cross their country."
"I shall go with Dorothy," declared the lion, "for I am tired of your city and long for the woods and the country again. I am really a wild beast, you know. Besides, Dorothy will need someone to protect her."
"That is true," agreed the woodman. "My axe may be of service to her, so I will also go with her to the land of the south." "When shall we start?" asked the scarecrow. "Are you going?" they asked in surprise. "Certainly. If it wasn't for Dorothy, I should never have had brains, so my good luck is all due to her, and I shall never leave her until she starts back to Kansas for good and all." "Thank you," said Dorothy gratefully. "You are all very kind to me, but I should like to start as soon as possible."
"We shall go tomorrow morning," returned the scarecrow. "Now, let us all get ready, for it will be a long journey."
"Good luck," said the Monkey King. "And remember, you can only call upon us one more time."
The next morning the sun shone brightly as our friends turned their faces towards the land of the south. They took a last look at the Emerald City. All they could see was a mass of towers and steeples behind the green walls, and high up above everything the spires and dome of the Palace of Oz. The first day's journey was through the green fields and bright flowers that stretched about the Emerald City on every side. They slept that night on the grass, with nothing but the stars over them, and they rested very well indeed. In the morning they travelled on and soon found themselves in a disagreeable country, full of bogs and marshes and covered with tall, rank grass. It was difficult to walk without falling into muddy holes, for the grass was so thick that it hid them from sight. However, by carefully picking their way, they got safely along until they reached solid ground. But here the country seemed wilder than ever, and after a long and tiresome walk through the underbrush, they entered a forest where the trees were bigger and older than any they had ever seen.
"This forest is perfectly delightful," declared the lion, looking around him with joy. "Never have I seen a more beautiful place."
"It seems gloomy," said the scarecrow.
"Not a bit of it," answered the lion. "I should like to live here all my life."
Before they had gone much farther, they heard a low rumble, as of the growling of many wild animals. They came to an opening in the wood in which were gathered hundreds of beasts of every variety. There were tigers and elephants and bears and wolves and foxes. The lion explained that the animals were holding a meeting, and he judged by their snarling and growling that they were in great trouble. As he spoke, several of the beasts caught sight of him, and at once the great assemblage hushed as if by magic. The biggest of the tigers came up to the lion and bowed low.
"Welcome, O King of Beasts," he said. "You have come in good time to fight our enemy and bring peace to all the animals of the forest once more."
"What is your trouble?" asked the lion.
"We are all threatened by a fierce enemy which has lately come into this forest. It is a most tremendous monster, like a great spider with a body as big as an elephant and legs as long as a tree trunk. It has 8 of these long legs, and as the monster crawls through the forest, he seizes an animal with a leg and drags it into his mouth, where he eats it as a spider does a fly. Not one of us is safe while this fierce creature is alive, and we had called a meeting to decide how to take care of ourselves when you came among us."
The lion thought for a moment.
"If I put an end to your enemy, will you bow down to me and obey me as king of the forest?" he said.
"We will do that gladly," returned the tiger.
"Where is this great spider of yours now?" asked the lion.
"Yonder among the oak trees," said the tiger, pointing with his forefoot.
"Take good care of these friends of mine," said the lion, "and I will go at once to fight the monster."
He bade his comrades goodbye and marched proudly away to do battle with the enemy. The great spider was lying asleep when the lion found him, and it looked so ugly that its foe turned up his nose in disgust. It had a great mouth with a row of sharp teeth a foot long, but its head was joined to the pudgy body by a neck as slender as a wasp's waist. This gave the lion a hint of the best way to attack the creature, and as he knew it was easier to fight it asleep than awake, he gave a great spring and landed directly upon the monster's back. Then, with one blow of his heavy paw, all armed with sharp claws, he knocked the spider's head from its body. Jumping down, he watched it until the long legs stopped wiggling, when he knew it was quite dead. The lion went back to the opening where the beasts of the forest were waiting for him and said proudly,
"You need fear your enemy no longer."
Then the beasts bowed down to the lion as their king, and he promised to come back and rule over them as soon as Dorothy was safely on her way to Kansas. The four travelers passed through the rest of the forest in safety, and when they came out from its gloom, they saw before them a steep hill, covered from top to bottom with great pieces of rock. They had nearly reached the first rock when they heard a rough voice cry out,
"Keep back!"
"Who are you?" asked the Scarecrow. Then a head showed itself over the rock, and the same voice said,
"This hill belongs to us, and we don't allow anyone to cross it."
"But we must cross it," said the Scarecrow. "We're going to the country of the Quadlings."
"But you shall not," replied the voice.
And there stepped from behind the rock the strangest man the travellers had ever seen. He was quite short and stout, and had a big head which was flat at the top and supported by a thick neck full of wrinkles. But he had no arms at all. And seeing this, the Scarecrow did not fear that so helpless a creature could prevent them from climbing the hill. So he said, "I'm sorry not to do as you wish, but we must pass over your hill whether you like it or not." Then he walked boldly forward. As quick as lightning, the man's head shot forward, and his neck stretched out until the top of the head, where it was flat, struck the Scarecrow in the middle and sent him tumbling over and over down the hill. Almost as quickly as it came, the head went back into the body, and the man laughed harshly and said,
"It isn't as easy as you think."
A chorus of boisterous laughter came from the other rocks, and Dorothy saw hundreds of the armless hammerheads upon the hillside, one behind every rock. The lion became quite angry at the laughter caused by the Scarecrow's mishap, and giving a loud roar that echoed like thunder, he dashed up the hill. Again a head shot swiftly out, and the great lion went rolling down the hill as if he'd been struck by a cannonball. Dorothy ran down and helped the Scarecrow to his feet. And the lion came up to her, feeling rather bruised and sore, and said,
"It is useless to fight people with shooting heads. No one can withstand them."
"What can we do then?" she asked.
"Call the winged monkeys," suggested the Tin Woodman. "You still have the right to command them once more."
"Very well," she answered, and putting on the golden cap, she uttered the magic words. The monkeys were as prompt as ever, and in a few moments the entire band stood before her.
"What are your commands?"
inquired the king of the monkeys, bowing low. "Carry us over the hill to the country of the Quadlings," answered the girl.
"It shall be done," said the king,
and at once the winged monkeys caught the four travellers and Toto up in their arms and flew away with them. As they passed over the hill, the hammerheads yelled with vexation and shot their heads high in the air, but they could not reach the winged monkeys, which carried Dorothy and her comrades safely over the hill and set them down in the beautiful country of the Quadlings.
"This is the last time you can summon us," said the leader to Dorothy. "So, goodbye, and good luck to you."
"Goodbye, and thank you very much," returned the girl, and the monkeys rose into the air and were out of sight in a twinkling. The country of the Quadlings seemed rich and happy. There was field upon field of ripening grain, with well-paved roads running between, and pretty rippling brooks with strong bridges across them. The fences and houses and bridges were all painted bright red, just as they'd been painted yellow in the country of the Winkies and blue in the country of the Munchkins. The Quadlings themselves, who were short and fat and looked chubby and good-natured, were dressed all in red,
which showed bright against the green grass and the yellowing grain. They started afresh and walked by the fields and across the pretty bridges until they saw before them a very beautiful castle. Before the gates were three young girls, dressed in handsome red uniforms trimmed with gold braid. And as Dorothy approached, one of them said, "Why have you come to the South Country?" "To see the good witch who rules here," she answered. "Let me have your names, and I will ask Glinda if she will receive you." They told who they were, and the girl soldier went into the castle. After a few moments, she came back to say that Dorothy and the others were to be admitted at once. Before they went in to see Glinda, they were taken to a room of the castle where Dorothy washed her face and combed her hair, and the lion shook the dust out of his mane, and the scarecrow patted himself into the best shape, and the woodman polished his tin and oiled his joints. When they were all quite presentable, they followed the soldier girl into a big room where the witch Glinda sat upon a throne of rubies. She was both beautiful and young to their eyes. Her hair was a rich red in colour and fell in flowing ringlets over her shoulders. Her dress was pure white, but her eyes were blue, and they looked kindly upon the little girl. "What can I do for you, my child?" she asked. Dorothy told the witch all her story, how the cyclone had brought her to the Land of Oz, how she had found her companions, and of the wonderful adventures they had met with. "My greatest wish now," she added, "is to get back to Kansas, for Aunt Em will surely be thinking something dreadful has happened to me, and that will make her put on mourning, and unless the crops are better this year than they were last, I am sure Uncle Henry cannot afford it." Glinda leaned forward and kissed the upturned face of the little girl. "Bless your dear heart," she said. "I am sure I can tell you of a way to get back to Kansas." Then she added, "But if I do, you must give me the golden cap." "Willingly," exclaimed Dorothy. "Indeed, it is of no use to me now, and when you have it, you can command the winged monkeys 3 times. "And I think I shall have need of their services just those 3 times, answered Glinda, smiling. Dorothy then gave her the golden cap, and the witch said to the scarecrow, "What will you do when Dorothy has left us?" "I will return to the Emerald City," he replied, "for Oz has made me its ruler, and the people like me. The only thing that worries me is how to cross the Hill of the Hammerheads." "By means of the golden cap, I shall command the winged monkeys to carry you to the gates of the Emerald City," said Glinda, "for it would be a shame to deprive the people of so wonderful a ruler." "Am I really wonderful?" asked the Scarecrow. "You are unusual," replied Glinda. Turning to the Tin Woodman, she asked, "What will become of you when Dorothy leaves this country?" He leaned on his axe and thought for a moment. Then he said, "The Winkies were very kind to me and wanted me to rule over them after the Wicked Witch died. I am fond of the Winkies, and if I could get back again to the country of the West, I should like nothing better than to rule over them forever." "My second command to the winged monkeys," said Glinda, "will be that they carry you safely to the land of the Winkies. Your brain may not be so large to look at as that of the Scarecrow, but you are really brighter than he is when you are well polished, and I am sure you will rule the Winkies wisely and well." Then the witch looked at the big, shaggy lion and asked, "When Dorothy has returned to her own home, what will become of you?"
"All over the Hill of the Hammerheads," he answered, "lies a grand old forest, and all the beasts that live there have made me their king. If I could only get back to that forest, I would pass my life very happily there."
"My third command to the winged monkeys," said Glinda, "shall be to carry you to your forest. Then, having used up the powers of the golden cap, I shall give it to the king of the monkeys, that he and his band may thereafter be free forevermore." The Scarecrow and the Tin Woodman and the Lion now thanked the good witch earnestly for her kindness, and Dorothy exclaimed, "You are certainly as good as you are beautiful, but you have not yet told me how to get back to Kansas." "Your silver shoes will carry you over the desert," replied Glinda. If you had known their power, you could have gone back to your Aunt Em the very first day you came to this country. But then I should not have had my wonderful brain, cried the Scarecrow. I might have passed my whole life in the farmer's cornfield. And I should not have had my lovely heart, said the Tin Woodman. I might have stood and rusted in the forest till the end of the world.
And I should have lived a coward forever, declared the Lion, and no beast in all the forest would have had a good word to say to me.
This is all true, said Dorothy, and I'm glad I was of use to these good friends. But now that each of them has what he most desired, I think I should like to go back to Kansas. The silver shoes, said the good witch, have wonderful powers. And one of the most curious things about them is that they can carry you to any place in the world in 3 steps, and each step will be made in the wink of an eye. All you have to do is to knock the heels together 3 times and command the shoes to carry you wherever you wish to go. If that is so, said the child joyfully, I will ask them to carry me to Kansas at once. She threw her arms around the Lion's neck and kissed him, patting his big head tenderly. Then she kissed the Tin Woodman, who was weeping in a way most dangerous to his joints. But she hugged the soft, stuffed body of the Scarecrow instead of kissing his painted face, and found she was crying herself at this sorrowful parting from her loving comrades. Glinda the Good stepped down from her ruby throne to give the little girl a goodbye kiss, and Dorothy thanked her for all the kindness she had shown to her friends and herself. Dorothy now took Toto up solemnly in her arms, and having said one last goodbye, she clapped the heels of her shoes together 3 times, saying, "Take me home to Aunt Em." Instantly she was whirling through the air so swiftly that all she could see or feel was the wind whistling past her ears. "Good gracious!" she cried, and found that she was sitting on the broad Kansas prairie, and just before her was the new farmhouse Uncle Henry had built after the cyclone had carried away the old one. Dorothy stood up and found that she was in her stockinged feet, for the silver shoes had fallen off in her flight through the air and were lost forever in the desert. Aunt Em had just come out of the house to water the cabbages when she looked up and saw Dorothy running towards her. "My darling child," she cried, folding the little girl in her arms and covering her face with kisses. "Where in the world did you come from?" "From the land of Oz," said Dorothy gravely. "And here is Toto, too. And oh, Aunt Em, I'm so glad to be home again."